My talk entitled A Brief History of Nanocrystal Quantum Dots. And I will speak about discovery of nanocrystal, major milestone in this field development, and several topics which are interesting for me personally. By no means my talk is comprehensive review of the field, but you all know the history is like a Russian doll. You open one story, inside of the story is different doll, different story. So you will hear the kind of theoretical version of the story. Вот видите, уже мышка пропала. Одну секундочку, я.
Нет, вот есть, пожалуйста, красная.
Вот это вот, она не в том месте, в этом проблема. Сейчас я обратно включусь.
А, Миша, а
мы восстановились?
Нет.
Да, а что?
Экрана нету.
Ну, это докладчик выключил share screen. Это не мы.
Это докладчик вышел. Окей, я включу share screen. Что, сейчас?
Сейчас видно.
Мышка куда-то пропала. Ну, черт с ней.
Без мышки плохо будет.
Без мышки будет плохо, да. Давайте я еще раз постараюсь включиться. Вы видите мой экран или нет?
Нет, мы не видим вашего экрана, мы видим вас в основном.
А сейчас?
И сейчас не видим. О, сейчас. Да, сейчас увидели.
Отлично. Но мышки нет. Сейчас будет мышка, надеюсь. О, появилась мышка, да?
Появилось.
Да. Here I show you TM image of bare-cut selenite nanocrystal. For chemists, this nanocrystal is essentially a three-dimensional potential box, which can find free motion of electron and hole, leading to and the size of this nanocrystal can be varied in various chemical means from 1 to 100 nanometer. For physicists, nanocrystal, it is an essential three-dimensional potential box, which confines carrier inside, leading to size-dependent discrete level structure and district spectra of optical excitation. So recent advances in the fabric. Recent advances, sorry?
May I ask, do you want to publish something about that? Is it peer-reviewed for to publish or just
Вы можете... Я говорил, Миша, я не получил approval на этот доклад. Когда он будет approval, вы можете делать с ним все, что хотите. Пока...
Какой-нибудь обзор, там, не знаю, в Science, там, в Nature, там, еще что-нибудь.
Нет? Ну, Саша, вопрос был в том, опубликованы ли у вас эти результаты.
Давайте поговорим после об этом, хорошо? Recent advances in physical fabrication, physical understanding, application of chemical synthesized nanosized semiconductor, such nanocrystal, nanorod, and nanoplate, driven by intense interest to the unusual potential use of electronic property. Wide class of semiconductor has been prepared in nanocrystal form today, listed here. Size and shape control tunability of the electronic and optical property. And here as examples show you tunability absorption band H of photoluminescence of cut selenite nanocrystal. You can see the absorption band H can be shifted.
Вопрос. Ты с решением киноуравнения, хоть когда я ему дело имел.
Повторите, пожалуйста. Может, кто, я не раз слышал вопроса. Можете повторить, пожалуйста? Алло?
Я думаю, это по ошибке кто-то случайно. Это
звук. Всем надо выключить микрофон.
Звук и...
So, and here I show size-dependent optical property of cut selenite.
Саша,
да?
I have a question.
Yeah.
Вот в последней фразе, какой смысл вкладывается в слово closer? Как по-русски это перевести? Я не понимаю. Multiple options и так далее. А closer than ever. Что значит closer?
Это значит, что мы, может быть, мой английский недостаточно
вот
хороший.
Вот-вот. Closer means вот-вот.
Вот-вот, да. Ну, я думаю, что это правильное выражение. Короче говоря, size and shape control tunability of this electronic property combined with ability to manipulate this freestanding nanocrystal with nanometer precision open exciting opportunity of creation novel functional device for wide range of application. This nanocrystal, colloidal nanocrystal, allow bottom-up chemical approach to assembly. Nanocrystal can be positioned and assembled in two-dimensional supercrystal and three-dimensional supercrystal, consumer-designed nanocrystal molecule, and functional nanocrystal biomolecule conjugate. And from this point of view, multiple applications of the fundamental property of this structure are closer than ever. То есть скоро придут. I will show you two examples of such application, which Navy especially interesting, и поэтому они платят мне деньги. First connected with observation of tunable gain, here you see tunable gain, and stimulated emission, observed by Klimov in cut selenite quantum dot solids. And this shows that one day we can make tunable mercury telluride or lead selenite nanocrystal laser working at 1.6 micron. Important wavelength for Navy because this wavelength propagates through wet atmosphere without absorption and scattering and ocularly safe. A second application connected with successful labeling of biological molecule by nanocrystal, which open opportunity of creation nanocrystal based ultra-sensitive detector of dangerous biological molecule and chemical agent. So research in nanocrystal field has been already translated in production of commercial devices. In May 2011, Nanosys company announced product called Quantum Dot Enhanced Film. This is thin film of semiconductor nanocrystal, which convert blue light of gallium nitride laser into red and green green light, and can be used in the liquid display And at the same time, Samsung Corporation advertise production of the 4-inch display, which has higher definition, lower power consumption than commercial liquid display. And they show it on this figure, which compare two picture, liquid crystal display and quantum dot display. And today, Quantum Dot TV is $3 billion production.
Which is quantum dots and which is liquid crystal?
This is quantum dot, this is liquid crystal.
Okay.
Okay, guys, again, I lost mice. I need to recover it. Женя, рад тебя видеть.
Это я тебя сбил, что ли?
Нет, это у меня какая-то история с мышкой, которую я не понимаю, что происходит.
Саша, мы при этом видели твою мышку. Пока.
Вы видели мою мышку, а я ее не вижу. Да. Вот поэтому и такая трудность возникает. Надо мне научиться, что с этим делать. Ну что сейчас?
Запустилось.
Запустилось, отлично. Надо запустить еще мышку. Это проблема.
О!
О, мышка запустилась. Так. Nanocrystal are most heavily studied among all nanoscale semiconductors. After 40 years of research, by the way, the side we understand основные электронные транспорт property of nanocrystal. The size dependence of this property was discovered independently two different materials. In semiconductor dope glasses by Alyosha Ekimov, at that time in Vavilov Institute, and aqueous solution by Louis Bruce at that time in Bell Lab. Unfortunately, I don't have picture of Alyosha and Bruce at the time of discovery, but this picture, they're still much younger than they are today. So this slab of glass, which Ekimov prepared in 1984, was first demonstration of effect of special confinement on optical property of nanocrystal. This glass contained homogeneous concentration of cadmium selenide. However, gradient of temperature was applied during nanocrystal growth, leading to gradual change of color from dark red to transparent. So there's similarity and difference in both discovery. In both cases, nanocrystal growth is a result of phase separation of a super saturated solution of nanocrystal and nanocrystal as a new phase. Size of nanocrystal control of diffusion of atom or ion to growing nuclei. And as a final size, it's controlled by duration of growth and it affects but process of growth interruption. The process called arrested precipitation. In both cases, the research was driven by pure curiosity. In the case of Alyosha Ekimov, it was what determined color of short filters. In the case of Bruce, what determined color of the aqueous solution with nanocrystal. None of them write the proposal, but in both cases, the administration of Bell Lab and Goya willingly agree to support their research. And analogy with superlattice existing by this time provided explanation why color of nanocrystal can be correlated by size. The difference was that Ekimov measured size of nanocrystal using small angle X-ray scattering, and Bruce measured the size using TEM. And another difference is that the Ekimov nanocrystal was prepared in Soviet Union in 1981, before first quantum well were grown in Alferov lab in 1984. So Bruce has opportunity to discuss his result with his colleague from Bell Lab, and Ekimov didn't have this opportunity. He find his neighbor, it was me, and we start long time discussion. We live in two neighbor house, and we start discussion of optical property of nanocrystal, sitting on his on my kitchen, drinking tea, and sometimes something stronger than tea. So it is important to mention that first observation of optical property of nanocrystal quantum dot was reported by Gross and Komplyansky in 1957. Although puzzling in time of discovery, this observation now well understood. They measure absorption spectrum of sodium chloride doped with kappa. And to make long story short, I will list the result of the measurement conducted at weakly doped nanocrystal. Absorption spectrum of sample with small kappa concentration as prepared was not different from absorption spectra of sodium chloride. 1 year later, as I written in the paper, they took the sample from the shelf. The absorption of sample showed two kappa chloride line and the splitting was practically the same in bulk caprochloride, but the line was shifted 100 MeV to the blue from the bulk volume. Again, it is written in the paper. 2 years later, they again take samples from the shelf and see this line were coincided with absorption spectra of bulk caprochloride. Today, it is absolutely clear the blue shift observed by the OSA is connected with special confinement of excitone and caprochloride nanocrystal. So the technology of colloidal nanocrystal particle glass is 1,000 years old. And best example of such glasses you can find in Paris, La Santé de Chapelle, Paris, or Notre Dame de Paris Cathedral. I hope that it is not destroyed. In modern time, physicists use such color glass as optical filters, so-called shot glasses. The description of this, how to prepare these glasses, you can find in the recipes in the book. Put in such and such compound in the glass melt, cool the melt down to such and such temperature, heat it up and keep at such temperature for a particular period of time. But this recipe, I believe, was translated to Russian from German when short glass technology was brought to Russia from Germany as a result of compensation. And then before this recipe was translated most probably from Latin to German. However, this recipe doesn't explain how color of glass was created. So in 1971, Alyosha Ekimov went to work to Yoffe Institute. And because Misha Tolstoy let him to do whatever he wants, he studied what is interesting for him. And he found that glass activation is a very interesting problem. So he decided to investigate mechanism responsible for this phenomenon. Experiment was undertaken on a four glass compound, glass activated by caprochloride, caprobromide, and cat sulfide and cat selenite. Ekimov's initial efforts to understand the absorption spectrum of glass activated by cat sulfide and cat selenite was unsuccessful. The doping created some broad light in absorption spectra, which changed depending on the temperature, heating, and duration of grow. And the first success comes with activation of glasses by caprochloride. This caprochloride showed two well-resolved spectra, which was shifted to the blue. And this actually started investigation of these glasses. So this figure shows you the first advice, the critical assistant come from the director of GOE, Petrovsky, who advised Ekimov group to study work of Lifshitz and Slezov, who report investigation of growth of small particle in solution. So this paper report, Lifshitz-Slezov reports on nanocrystal growth, which is based on diffusion control phase decomposition of separated solid solution. And they describe theory of asphalt repening developed by Lifshitz and Slezov in 1950. In this the theory give radius of nanocrystal dependence, depending on duration of growth, where D is diffusion coefficient, and delta E is activation energy. And turn out that size of nanocrystal grown by Ekimov very well described by this technique. And here I show you result of the investigation. Indeed, radius nanocrystal depend on the duration of nanocrystal growth by tau t to the power 1/3. This also rate depend one over logarithmic scale rate of growth was depends like one over temperature. And this understanding of nanocrystal growth provide to Ekimov powerful technique for synthesize nanocrystal with controllable size. This start new era of controlled growth of nanocrystal. The growth of nanocrystal aqueous solution doesn't have this long history. Only in 1982, the first growth of colloidal cut sulfide in aqueous solution was reported by Armin Hengelin. And 1 year later, Bruce working with cut selenide aqueous solution noticed that color of solution change with aging.
And can I ask?
Yes, sure.
You use here on this slide colloidal cadmium sulfide. So Ekimov's nanocrystals were also colloidal, or there is some difference?
No, there is a colloidal, but they were grown in glass. It was short glasses. So they put some...
Is it possible to call Ekimov's samples colloidal or not?
Yes, it is possible to call Ekimov's sample colloidal, mm-hmm. from my point of view. Mm-hmm. So Bruce noticed that color of his solution, which cut sulfide nanocrystal, changed with time, and he theorized that this color connected with special quantum confinement effect. So he decided to slow down the nanocrystal growth by decreasing the amount of precursor and decreasing of temperature growth, and slowing down this growth of this nanocrystal, he was able to observe shift of absorption band age from the bulk value of cut sulfide, as well as a measure average size of this nanocrystal. And here you see absorption spectra of nanocrystal with 45 angstrom diameter, I think, at this time, and which was shifted to the blue. And he understood that it's quantum confinement effect. And now for him was a problem, how to stop nanocrystal growth. In the case of Ekimov, it was very simple. You reduce temperature, diffusion of ion to grow nanocrystal slow down, or you can completely stop. But it's not possible to do in aqueous solution. And that is why he start to think about the other way to stop this process. His group decided to use inverse micelle approach. The cage created by inverse micelle was supposed to limit the size of nanocrystal. In addition, they used solvent, which allowed to anneal high temperature solvent, without anneal defect in nanocrystal. And initially they used so-called, I cannot pronounce this chemical expression, TBP. And then by lucky accident, they discover the best solvent in order to get annealing of the effect. It's a 50% mixture of TBP and TBPO. Using this annealing, they were able to find bump at absorption, which corresponds to nanocrystal with diameter 3-4 nanometer. Yes? And occasionally they got sample with very narrow side distribution, and Monge Bavendi, who was postdoc also with Bruce, at this time used the sample to measure first fluorescent line narrowing in cut selenite nanocrystal. And here I show from this figure where he discovered stock shift of photoluminescence along decay time. So today almost impossible to imagine initial skepticism of solid-state communities to ideas that...
Саша, I'm sorry, there is a question of Александр Головатенко. Да. Саша.
Да, у меня вот такой вопрос. Fluorescence line narrowing, который изображен на рисунке, отличается ли он по физике от рамановского рассеяния? Или это именно люминесценция?
Это именно люминесценция.
Спасибо.
So, вы видите stock shift of the стоковский сдвиг, который вы видите, зависит size depend. Вы видите основную линию, then вы видите phononassistor line.
Ну, просто вопрос связан с тем, что вот мы с коллегами в лаборатории обсуждали, что это может быть рассеяние из светлого экситона в темный. И вот такой вот...
Нет, сначала вы возбуждаете bright exciton.
Да, да, да.
Он релаксирует темный экситон. И вы видите обычно маленький bump. Это не low temperature, small bump at the position of dark exciton. And then you see phononassistor line.
Да.
Okay, today it's almost impossible to imagine initial skepticism of solid state community regarding the idea that nanosized semiconductor crystal, which contain only several hundred atoms, can have regular electronic and optical property, which controlled by one parameter, the nanocrystal size. In your institute, this modeling, however, was protected by approval of Alyosha Efros, and nobody challenged us. But I vividly remember my discussion with very famous Russian theoretical physicist in Moscow. He told me, Sasha, I always think that you're a reasonable guy. Actually, he used different words. And he said, do you really believe that using effective mass approximation, you can describe the Ekimov experiment? And actually, pressure was quite significant, not only on me as theoretical physicist, but on Alyosha Ekimov. So when Alyosha tried to find at that time limit of effective, so he called it effective mass approximation, to find smaller size of nanocrystal, which this line disappear. Actually, he found this limit, but this result unfortunately never was published. So, going to this pressure and trying to make our paper published in Soviet peer-reviewed journal, we make dumbest thing in our life. We start to call this nanoscience object microcrystals. So if you, from 1982, you will see we always call this nanocrystal microcrystal, although it's very stupid. And never, nobody should repeat this mistake again. So here I show, from 1985, Ekimov was able to establish size dependence of four semiconductor compound and slow change of nanocrystal size from practically microscopic to nanoscale, down to 2.5 nanometer diameter, slowly convince community that indeed you can characterize sample by size, one parameter, nanocrystal size. And here I show example of such spectra measured by Alyosha Ekimov in absorption spectra at helium temperature. You see a sample with average radius 2 nanometer, 2.9 nanometer, and very large, 31 nanometer. The absorption spectrum of Capra chloride controlled by two lines connected with two valence subband. It reveals band structure of gallium arsenide. The loss of band edge subband is twofold degenerate, and the upper subband is fourfold degenerate. That is why you see much broader line above. So the absorption spectra of largest 31 nanometer is practically identical to absorption spectra of bulk Capra chloride. And here Ekimov plotted, and Anushenko plotted the size dependence of these two peaks plot is the reverse way of nanocrystal radius. This line approximates to the bulk value of two excitonic peak in copper chloride. And this dependence can be described by this simple expression particle in the box model. And total finalized bulk energy gap minus energy binding energy of exciton plus energy of confined exciton, where M is exciton center of mass motion mass. The next compound, and we stop, no? The next compound Alyosha studied, it was cat sulfide. And here you see the absorption spectra of four samples of cat sulfide. Again, 1.2, 1.5, 2.3 nanometer in very large 33 nanometer radius. The nanometer radius cat sulfide practically identical absorption spectra, practically identical to bulk spectra. You can see fine structure of exciton, pentH exciton connected with three valence subband of cat sulfide. The decrease of nanocrystal size shifts the absorption pentH and lead to oscillation in absorption spectra connected with transition to lowest quantum confined level of electron. And this level of electron is characterized by angular momentum and energy spectrum described as this simple expression, which you can find in any handbook on quantum mechanics. It inversely proportional to effective mass and square of nanocrystal radius, and phi are the root of some Bessel function. And this paper, Ikimov borrow atomic notation SPD for level with angular momentum 0, 1, and 2. And in parabolic band approximation, optical transition allowed only between level with same quantum number, show schematic right here. And the linear absorption spectra for this nanocrystal described as this simple expression, bulk energy gap, energy of confinement of electron plus energy of confinement of hole with the same number, minus energy of electron-hole Coulomb interaction, which can be calculated pervasively. Actually, it was done by Bruce. Here I show you size dependence of absorption spectra measured by Ikimov, plotted the reverse square of nanocrystal radius. You clearly see three transition to 1s, to 1p, and 1d level. In this scale 1 over square, the dependence are not linear, and this connected with non-parabolicity of electron effective mass. The spectra doesn't show any fine structure connected with whole level, and this because this sample were grown using Oswald Rippenick technique, leading to dispersion around 15%. And due to large mass of heavy hole, the fine structure fall was completely washed out in this spectrum.
Коллеги, по-моему, вопрос есть. Извините.
Я слушаю.
Сейчас. Кто-то из слушателей поднял руку с ником Саша, но, видимо, не хочет задавать вопрос. Извините, все.
Sorry, I had a problem with microphone. Is phi square localization volume of the carrier?
Say it again, please. Повторите, пожалуйста.
Is phi square in the formula as the upper right angle is the volume of the carrier localization?
No, it is the root of Bessel function for Bessel function 0, 1, and 2. It is pi 4.49 or 5.26.
Okay, yes, thank you.
So, Саша, извините, можно еще я вас спрошу вот по предыдущему слайду, вот здесь вот? А я вижу так, что есть два режима. Ну, известно, что либо экситон квантуется как целое, как у вас на левой картинке, либо в основном как независимые электронные дырки с клоновской поправкой. А вот переход между этими режимами наблюдался тогда, вот в 80-е годы, или это потом как-то стали изучать?
Да, мы наблюдали этот переход. И была статья по купромо-брому, у которой, значит, в купром-хлоре радиус экситона 0,7 нанометр. Для всех капрохлорид нанокристаллов и всегда в V-confinement режиме. cut sulfide, you can have strong confinement regime, weak confinement regime, but much гораздо проще исследовать Курпом бром, потому что его радиус, я забыл, какого размера, но и вы точно проходите промежуточные размеры. И мы с Алешей, у нас была опубликована работа, и Advanced Parametric, пробная функция, прекрасно описывала зависимости пиков.
Спасибо.
Так, hole level was discovered much later, when Akimov was able to reduce dispersion of nanocrystal size from 15%, which result of Oswald ripening process, to 5%. Actually, it makes sense to tell you how you do it, because the people who grow colloidal nanocrystals use exactly the same technique. Idea was the following. You first create multiple nuclei of nanocrystals at high temperature, because creation of nuclei clear correlate, fluctuation correlation not correlate with temperature. And then with this amount of large nuclei, you start to create grow nanocrystal. It was difficult to do in this case, kind of grow large nanocrystal, because finally you always go to Oswald ripening regime. But for small nanocrystal, you can get nanocrystal with very small size dispersion, because creation of the nuclei is process controlled by fluctuation and has very rapid, quite narrow size distribution. So when Akimov uses two-stage technique of nanocrystal grow, he was able to create nanocrystal with quite narrow size distribution. And here I show you absorption spectra and second of spectra of second derivative of nanocrystal with average radius 2.1, 2.6, and 3.8 angstrom. On the first glance, you see right away that this spectra cannot be described using parabolic band approximation even qualitatively. So to describe the spectra, we use theory which I developed together with Garik Grigorian. We describe fine structure of exciton in six-band model. And also we take into account non-parabolicity electron spectra in Castellanite. And here I show you size dependence of loss electron and hole level. We use some funny nomenclature for this level. So you see transition to one S electron level I allow from many hole level which is mixed SD character symmetry, and transition to P level are possible only from many levels which have mixed PF level symmetry. And using this optical transition energy, we were able quite good describe the second derivative spectra. This vertical line reflect magnitude of optical transition and energy position of this transition. It mainly work by Anna Rodina, who calculated this transition. So something happened here. Just a second.
Was this the first paper published by Anna Rodina? No?
No, it was not first paper published by Anna Rodina. I think the first paper Anna published with me, it was on Igor Uraltsev, a paper on the behavior of exciton in the quantum wall localization in magnetic field, if I remember. Anna, am I right?
Да, в 1988 первая статья, только под другой фамилией вначале.
Just a second.
Поэтому никто не знает.
Sorry. It was pity, it was good paper. Just a second.
Статью знаю. Не знают, что моя.
Мы, Саша, снова ваших слайдов не видим.
Сейчас что-то случилось у меня, ребята. Сейчас.
Промежутки могу дополнить, что в 89-м году была статья по нанокристаллам тоже. Уже.
Вы еще учились, да?
Да, диплом был в 90-м году.
Угу.
Еще училась.
А кто вас познакомил с Сашей Эфросом?
Как вы думаете, Женя? Женя, как вы думаете? Ты гадайте с трех раз.
Не знаю.
Вы Мишу Иванова не знаете?
Нет.
Ну.
Уральцев, что ли?
Миша Иванов. Нет.
Михаил Георгиевич Иванов привел меня на базовую кафедру, которую был Рубен Павлович Сысян тогда занимался, так, заведовал. И я пришла в лабораторию Рубен Павловича Сысяна, и он отдал меня Саше Эфросу. Кто уж там это придумал первый?
Саша, я не знаю, у вас сейчас не такой режим слайдов.
Что-то произошло, я не знаю.
Да, произошло. Теперь у вас показывает окно PowerPoint обычное, но не ваше, не то, что мы должны видеть.
Ага, Саш, там понятно. Надо поменять экраны.
Ребята, дайте одну секунду.
Поменять местами экраны. Где-то наверху.
Сейчас надо быть. Сначала открыть PowerPoint.
А Бавенди у кого учился?
Бавенди делал постдок in the group. Он был постдоком у Луиса Брюса.
Ага.
Тут все отслеживается хорошо. Сейчас, одну секундочку, ребята. Ой, слайд-шоу. From current slide. Okay, now.
Саша, а у тебя монитор с квантовыми точками?
Ну, конечно. Как ты догадался? Что сейчас вы видите?
Не тот рабочий.
Тоже не тот. Это подсказки мы видим.
Там, где display settings, по-моему. Саша, где display settings?
Нет, guys.
Display settings. Вот наверху у тебя display settings, и там надо поменять местами. Вот, своп, вот это первое. Своп презента.
Ну, что вы видите сейчас?
Нажимайте, хуже не будет, Саша. Нажимайте, хуже не будет. Аня плохого не посоветует.
Нажми туда. Нажми на
вот этот своп. Нет, я не могу. Нет, гайс.
Ты на него курсор поставил, но не нажал.
Гайс, тихо. Сейчас. Сделаем снова шер. Ай-яй-яй-яй. Так, теперь мы хотим share. Так. Как сейчас?
Вот, замечательно. Идеально.
Замечательно, хорошо. Ну, мышка пропала. Вот как вам нравится?
Вот появилась. Есть.
Хорошо. I believe that we can separate this 40 years of nanocrystalline integration in two well-defined periods. BTP and ATP. That is before Z paper and after Z paper. In 1991, Monge Bavendi, former Louis Bruce postdoc, moved to MIT, where he found many very gifted students, some of the most famous, Chris Moody and David Noritz. And 2 years later, they published first paper which report regular colloidal nanocrystal growth with very narrow size distribution. And here I show you three critical figures from this paper. First paper, we show how the narrowing nanocrystal size dispersion of castellanite nanocrystal using size selective precipitation. Second figure show remarkable control of nanocrystal size in aqueous solution. They were able to grow nanocrystal with radius from 12 angstrom to 115 angstrom. And final figure shows that this technology was applied not only to cut selenite, but also cut tellurite and cut sulfide. In contrast to Ekimov technology, this is the technology allowed to prepare powder of colloidal nanocrystal, which can be used in various applications and allow bottom-up chemical approach to assembly. That is why thousands of scientists and engineers use the technology modification today. And just yesterday, I looked on the Google, this paper was cited more than 10,000 times. And this year, Bhavendi and Muri become Clarity Citation Laureate in Chemistry 2020. New colloidal technology paves the way to forward to many new potential applications of nanocrystal. And some of these applications connected with further development of material result from the paper. Let me list major of them, which I consider milestone in nanocrystal development. First is successful grow of core shell structure by Heinz and Philippe Guillon-Sernest. They were able to grow cut selenite nanocrystals surrounded by zinc sulfide shell. And this figure show that this result of the shell increased the photoluminescence efficiency of nanocrystal by factor 6. Next important paper. A growth of three-dimensional periodic of nanocrystal, first reported by Chris Moody and Bhavendi group at that time. And this paper had a great promise because instead of limited number of atoms, which nature used to create solid state, one can use unlimited variety of the various nanocrystals and create three-dimensional super solid state material. Here I show image of this TM image of this supercrystal which Bhavendi Chris Moody created in 95. Next critical step. Penck and Alivizatos, using some special precursor, were able to grow elongated nanocrystal and control this elongated nanocrystal shape. And here I show T image of this elongated nanocrystal, which now called nanoros. Fourth important step, Philippe Guillon-Sernest demonstrated that you can electrochemically dope nanocrystal. And here I show you infrared absorption in this nanocrystal, where transition occurs between 1s ground electron and 1p second excited level in nanocrystal with different size. You see the line shifted to the high energy. Next critical step, developed by David Norris, doping of the nanocrystal with impurity. David Norris successfully put manganese inside high-quality zinc selenite nanocrystal. And here I show several, and actually demonstrate the self-purification idea which was commonly used to explain difficulty is doping nanocrystal is wrong. Actually, this was idea was born in Soviet Union and Yoff Institute. So here I show the photoluminescence of manganese dope zinc selenite nanocrystal, the fine structure of EPR, which clearly indicate that manganese sitting inside zinc sulfide selenite shell, giant MCD signal connected with splitting of the lowest electron hole sublevel in manganese by effective magnetic field of manganese. Next fascinating development is another control of colloidal nanocrystal shape. Sandrine and Benoit Dauberté successfully grow so-called nanoplatelet. It is freestanding of colloidal material, which have electronic property of two-dimensional quantum well, and here is the absorption of this two-dimensional quantum well, which clearly indicate heavy hole and light hole kind of transition, which shifted with decrease of the nanoplatelet thickness. Finally, it's a more recent development, it's reversible cation exchange with genetic development, because this experiment show you can remake nanostriche completely different way without changing anion substructure. And here first time it was demonstrated cut selenite, which was exchanged to silver selenite, and again reversible exchange back to cut selenite. And here you see X-ray diffraction, fluorescence spectra, and absorption, which confer this remarkable modifications of material with the same anion subglasses. So the widely tunable absorption spectra are transformed to widely tunable emission spectra. And here I showed you vulnerable to widely tunable emission spectra of indium arsenide, indium phosphide, and cut selenide, which was first demonstrated by Paul Levisator, which changed the size of this nanocrystal. This tunability of absorption spectra, which cover practically the entire region of optical spectra, with great chemical flexibility, one can grow a alloy of nanocrystal, nanocrystal solid, or three-dimensional array of nanocrystal. Combined with great optical stability of nanocrystal, one can put billion of photons on nanocrystal, and their property don't change, determine the major nanocrystal application. It was initially clear, and I'm pretty sure that it is, will be in the future. But what was discovered is the photoluminescence quantum yield of this structure is always less than 100% or in standard nanocrystal. And in some way, it is intrinsic property of nanocrystal. Imagine your irritation and frustration if your bulb of your reading lamp start to blink. And exactly the same feeling experienced scientists and engineers in Bell Lab in 1996 when they discovered that all nanocrystals they study using single quantum dot spectroscopy exhibit intermittency of photoluminescent intensity under steady state excitation. As is shown here, you see that time dependence of photoluminescent intensity exhibit sequence of on period and off period. For cut selenide nanocrystal covered by zinc sulfide shell, duration of on period is much longer than duration of on period in bare nanoparticle, which have very low quantum yield and the dark most of the time. Today, this effect was discovered at practically all temperature and all semiconductor nanocrystal, nanorods, porous silicon, and nanowire.
Саша, мы все хорошо видим и слышим.
Но мой компьютер не справляется немножко. Окей.
У вас, наверное, мышка какая-нибудь фэнси без провода. В этом-то все и дело.
Нет, у меня мышка с проводом. Я давно от этих идей отказался.
Мышка наружка.
Сейчас попробуем все сделать сначала. Ну что, видно?
Нет, не видно.
Ничего не видно. То есть вас видно, а экрана нет.
What about now?
Сейчас лучше, да, все появилось.
Okay, давайте я запущу мышку. Это что-то с мышкой происходит, конечно. So when it effect was observed, it was not clear, but today there's consensus that blinking they observed connected with the fact that under illumination nanocrystals become ionized or charged and then consequently neutralized. Indeed, if you photoexcite neutral nanocrystal under normal condition, this nanocrystal always emit photon at the band edge, and you should see luminescence. If you excite charged nanocrystal, a trickle process which is known as non-radiative Fourier recombination, when annihilation energy of this pair is transferred to extra electron hole. And in small size nanocrystals, this process, non-radiative Fourier recombination, is much faster than radiative recombination. So in this case, photoluminescence of nanocrystal is completely quenched. What remains unclear, however, how this ionization neutralization process occur. It is clear that after ionization electron, which quench luminescence, this electron hole ejector from nanocrystal should come back and restore neutrality of nanocrystal, restore luminescence. But how it occurs still remain not completely clear. And many groups trying to answer on this question using different means. And probably there are multiple answers in each of this question. Oops. Oops, no. So theoretically, three mechanisms of nanocrystallization were suggested. First is direct quantum mechanical tunneling of photoexcited electron hole to some trap at the nanocrystal surface. Second is a thermal ejection of electron hole into this deep trap if the band offset is small. And finally, it was Auger ionization of nanocrystal where we simultaneously create two electron hole pair. In this case, annihilation energy of one electron hole pair go on ejection of particle out of nanocrystal. Position and energy of this localized trap, the surface obviously depend on the chemical perturbation of the surface and matrix where nanocrystal is sitting. And neutralization obviously occurs through quantum mechanical tunneling or through thermal ejection from the trap. The efficiency of all this process depends strongly on nanocrystal size, intensity of excitation, degree of perturbation, etc., etc. To try to answer this question, many groups start to study probability, statistic of probability of and on interval. And when they do it, they discover that this probability described by Pauli law, where nu is between 1.8 to 1.4. Such Pauli law dependence on the duration of on and off interval apply absent of average photoluminescent dark and bright period and has unpleasant practical consequences. For example, if nanocrystalline dark state, you cannot predict generally when and if this nanocrystal become bright again. In order to suppress blinking, many groups try to grow nanocrystal with very thick shell. Indeed, no matter how ionization occur, the thick shell should prevent escape of electron hole to the surface. And the first report on this topic by Klimov and Benoit group, indeed confirms the thick shell work. And Machler paper, they study duration of on periods with shell 20 millisecond cathode for off period of luminescence. And this indeed has, yes?
I'm sorry, may I interrupt? Извините, yeah. У меня вопрос, может быть, очень наивный. Вот там написано наверху формула для распределения интервалов темных, интервалов включения.
Да.
А как-то из не знаю, каких-то теоретических или физических соображений можно понять, почему она вот такая степенная?
Да, но можно понять, потому что если вы возьмете некое экспоненциальное распределение времен и усредните ее, скажем, по расстоянию до импьюрити.
То есть это эффект ансамбля квантовых
точек? Это эффект ансамбля, но вы не можете получить, вы можете получить power dependence, но вы, и она даст вам 1.5. если вы проделаете. Но вы не можете получить, скажем, это же время для, отпрыгивания, то есть confused немножко. Я забыл, off – это отпрыгивание или возврат? Возврат, наверное. Вы не можете описать... Он вы можете описать таким образом, а off вы не можете таким образом описать. В общем, тут какая-то... Миша, я сейчас не могу сообразить.
Хорошо, ладно, неважно.
Но вы правильно говорите, что усреднение... Для одного из процессов усреднение по разным глубинам trap или по разным... Вы можете получить power dependence. Для второго
процесса... А на одиночных нанокристаллах такого... не делают? Или просто...
Нет, для одиночного как раз легко, потому что вы можете делать распределение ловушек на разное расстояние и получить вот это...
Хорошо, но экспериментально просто в одиночном тогда было бы, наверное, экспонента какая-то. И если вы берете один кристалл и не усредняете по ансамблю.
По ансамблю ловушек.
Ловушек много в каждом нанокристалле.
Да, ловушек в каждом отдельном нанокристалле много.
Все, понял, спасибо.
Угу. Значит, it is 20 microsecond cut-off time is good. However, majority of nanocrystals continue blink. И the only sure way to suppress blinking is suppress the origin of the blink, suppress non-radiative Fourier process, in charge nanocrystal. Sorry?
Я думаю, все нормально, можно продолжать.
To answer, so the question is, can we suppress blinking, can we suppress radiative Fourier recombination? To answer this question, first, let's understand why Fourier process is so efficient in nanocrystal. And I would like to remind you that in bulk semiconductor, like hard selenide, Auger processes are suppressed. Indeed, let's consider Auger recombination of two electron and one hole in bulk material. The process during which, say, we have two electron and one hole, after electron recombination with hole, the second electron should get all this energy of this recombination. And Auger process satisfies the energy conservation law, which is energy gap plus kinetic energy of two electron plus kinetic energy of hole should be equal to kinetic energy of electron in final state. It also should satisfy momentum conservation. So this momentum of this three particle initial state should be equal to momentum electron in final state. It is clear that after Auger process, the final electron have very large energy, larger energy gap, and large momentum. And momentum conservation implies that initial particle also should have quite large momentum, and there is kinetic energy associated with this momentum. So analysis of these two conservation law tell us that in order to Auger process happen in the bulk, this three particles should have some minimal kinetic energy, and there's kinematic energy threshold, which in bulk material proportional to the energy gap. And the probability of Fourier process in the bulk should be described by Arrhenius law, where in exponent you have ratio of bulk energy gap to the temperature. And clear this Fourier rate suppressed in wide gap semiconductor, if energy gap much larger than temperature. In confined structure. Lifting of momentum conservation. Remove this kinematic energy threshold. And AG process doesn't have this large suppression. So let's consider rate of AG recombination in nanocrystal. It generally can be described by Fermi golden rule, because in final state, electron hole who has large energy escape very fast. And the major problem of calculation of AG process in confined structure are connected with accurate estimation of this matrix element, which is taken between multi-electron initial state in the ground state, two electron, one hole, or two electron, two hole, and final state when one of this particle electron hole in highly excited state. At the first glance, the magnitude of this matrix element should be on the order average Coulomb interaction energy, E square over kappa A, where A is non-crystal radius. This is wrong answer, however, because in final state, electron hole wave function are rapidly oscillate. It can be characterized by some momentum. In order to estimate in the first approximation, integral with rapidly oscillation function, with smooth function, gives you zero. So in order to estimate this matrix element, you need to find large momentum K in Fourier expansion wave function of ground state, which would match to momentum electron hole in final state. If such momentum exists in the place where particle kinetic energy or its uncertainty has maximum. For example, if you would study rate of AG process in for exciton bound to neutral donor, so you have two electron in one hole, the AG process would happen right at the center of Coulomb impurity, where potential energy go to infinity and kinetic minus infinity, kinetic energy goes to plus infinity in order to have final energy. And AG process will happen right at the center of Coulomb impurity, where electron can pick up this kinetic energy. So if you would able to visualize this process, you will see phantom of electron going from the center of impurity. In the case of nanocrystal, AG process happening right at the nanocrystal surface due to large uncertainty of momentum here. And this explains why AG processes are so efficient in small size nanocrystal with large surface to volume ratio. This quality of consideration already tell us what we need to do in order to suppress AG process. We need to have soft confinement potential, which doesn't have this abrupt interfaces, where, which are places where electron can pick up this large kinetic energy. And generally, you can state that confinement profile with a abrupt boundary generate high frequency component in the wave function, a large Fourier component for large momentum. Soft confinement profile generate only low frequency component in the wave function, a small Fourier component for the large momentum. And you can easily confirm by direct calculation of Fourier component for wave function confined in the rectangular potential and parabolic potential. The second are exponentially smaller for large momentum. Consequently, parabolic well should have exponentially smaller rate of AG processes. To confirm this hand waving explanation, we conducted calculation of AG process in quantum well, which have different softness. This figure shows the rate of AG process calculated for one dimensional quantum well as a function of quantum well thickness, this shown by blue line. Softness of confined potential we modeled by this profile, which has nu as a degree of abruptness. If nu go to infinity, this potential has a rectangle shape, and nu equal to show the potential which is most softer potential provided by this class of function. The green potential reduce with nu equal 6, reduce rate of AG process, finally new equal to reduce rate of Ajax process by several order of magnitude.
Саша,
yes.
Извините, а я еще спрошу. А вот тут видны такие как бы резкие провалы скорости, да, при каких-то определенных да, ширинах. Миша. Вот с чем это связано?
Миша, это интерференция. Я сначала не верил, что такое может наблюдено, и не хотел это обсуждать, но если вы считаете rate of G просто напрямую, вы видите, что для на каких-то энергии этот матричный элемент просто пропадает. Для реальных структур я думал всегда, что это не физично, потому что вы всегда у вас есть некие уширения для каких-то нанокристаллов, они немножко отличаются от других. И это, эти минимумы очень узкие, они полностью замоются. Но мне кажется, что это явление, которое может наблюдаться для каких-то хорошо сделанных структур или в индивидуальном нанокристалле.
Понятно. Спасибо.
То это реальный эффект расчета, который
вот показывает еще... для каких... Саша, извините, еще вопрос от Андрея Акимова.
Да.
Андрей?
Я слышал. Андрей, unmute your microphone.
Андрей, вас не слышно. Ну, я не знаю. Давайте пока продолжим, может быть.
Он вспомнит, да. Да. So, question arises, how to make the soft confinement potential? The first report I saw on this topic was from Samsung Corporation. At some MRS meeting, they show that they grow this step-like confinement quantum dots. And it is clear that such step of confinement reduce rate of Ajax process because softness is not determined only by form of potential, also determined by the height of this potential here. And here we show, I show you calculation of rate of Ajax process depending on the confinement well height.
Саш, можно вопрос? Сейчас слышно
да.
меня?
Да.
Вот с АЖ-процессами, это как-то связано? АЖ-процессы участвуют в процессах релаксации, потому что там было много споров, я помню, о Фоунен Боттлнек. По идее, чтобы вот то, что вы рассказываете, как-то электроны и дырки должны быть на основных уровнях, но они должны туда попасть еще.
Да.
Во-первых, как они туда попадают, если попадают, а потом эти же процессы могут быть, пока они ну, носители...
В возбужденном состоянии. Да?
В возбужденном состоянии. И тогда, собственно говоря, эти же процессы будут объяснять процесс релаксации, потому что это была в свое время загадка. Я не знаю, решена она или нет в настоящее время.
Да, мы, ну, она частично решена, частично не решена. С Василием Харченко вы показали, что, да, действительно, то, что вы говорите, абсолютно правильно. Это было обсуждено после статьи этой французской группы про Funnel Bottleneck и нанокристалл, которая предсказывала, что лазер никогда не может работать на квантовых точках. Это и объяснение было связано с тем, что, скажем, электрон для электронного уровня он должен преодолеть расстояние между уровнями confinement 100 mV. У вас нету такого фанона. Поэтому релаксация электрона на основное состояние подавлена. И была работа, которая предсказывала, что лазер на квантовых точках никогда не может работать due to phonon bottleneck. Мы с Василием Харченко и моим боссом в НРЛ показали, что это неправильно. Потому что если у вас электрон сидит на P-состоянии, а дырка уже срелаксировала в основное состояние, вы можете делать AG-like relaxation. So inelastic scattering of electron, when electron go to the ground state, а дырка подпрыгнет выше и опять быстро срелаксирует. Но это хорошо, когда, скажем, у вас есть плотное, высокое плотное состояние для дырок и редкое плотное состояние для электронов. Но если у вас расстояние между дырками, электронами тоже большие, что тогда? Будет ли электронная дырка релаксировать на дно? Вот этот вопрос не остался, неразрешенным. Были отдельные работы Филиппа Гионса и Анеста, который показал, что этот процесс может идти за счет высокоэнергетичных фанонов органических материал, сидящих на поверхности нанокристаллов. Но потом оказалось, что это ошибка. Короче говоря, этот процесс разрешен, но не полностью.
Ясно. Спасибо.
Саша, еще один вопрос от Сергея Григорьевича Тиходеева.
Да.
Спасибо. Саша, вот то, что... Спасибо. Вот то, что здесь нарисовано, на самом деле очень напоминает модную тему сейчас в электродинамике «bound state and continuum». Ведь фактически это ожерекомбинация, это же в континуум у тебя вылетает эта самая лишняя частица.
Да.
Вот при некоторых там значениях получается так, что по какой-то симметрии вследствие интерференции запрещено это дело. Так что,
точно, точно видимо... такой же. Да, это точно так же. Сережа,
так что,
абсолютно. Да, это
так что
точно
так же. Надо срочно делать и продавать под этим соусом.
Нет, но это же результат прямого расчета. Тут ничего не придумано, не убрано, не добавлено. Но для ансамбля нанокристаллов это нереалистично, потому что если вы посмотрите ширину...
Ну, конечно, понятно. Да.
Это несерьезно. Но тем не менее, на индивидуальном нанокристалле вы можете клеймить, может быть, есть golden size нанокристалл, magic size нанокристалл, вы уже просто suppress, if you completely neglect them.
Но
когда эта работа делалась, я не верил в это, а сейчас у меня есть сомнение, что это может быть что-то реальное. Короче говоря, long story short, this Samsung claim that they have this nanocrystal with suppressed AG processes and due to replacement of large potential jump in many small steps, because it reduces AG rate. And I believe, and we confirm it by some calculation. However, this Samsung didn't continue this research because the administration decided that they will make indium phosphide quantum dots for quantum dot TV instead of cut selenide, which is a toxic material. But almost 10 years later, Viktor Klimov reproduced the growth of such a multi-shell structure. And he demonstrated the continuous gray shell, giant cut selenite, zinc cut selenite nanocrystal, indeed doesn't show any blinking. And more than that, it doesn't show any wandering of exciton line. You see emission line extremely narrow. And he compared with standard giant cut selenide cut sulfide nanocrystal where blinking already suppressed. But line is much larger and you see clearly some jump in emission of the exciton line connected with all the charging of the surface of this nanocrystal. So after all this tremendous technological effort to make non-blinking nanocrystal with high quantum yield, unexpectedly 5 years ago, Maxim Kovalenko's group discovered outstandingly good perovskite nanocrystals, which without surface perturbation show remarkably bright photoluminescence with quantum yield 50-90% at quantum yield at room temperature. And here I show the emission reported for this class of nanocrystal, cesium and bromide, iodide, chloride, and the alloy which cover the entire region of optical spectra. The nanocrystal has cubic shape. It is the image of bromide nanocrystal. And this high quantum yield was traced down to surprisingly fast emission lifetime, which at room temperature 20 times faster than in Casselinite nanocrystal, so it's around 1-2 nanosecond. At its helium temperature, it is 250 picosecond, which is 1,000 times shorter than what was measured in Casselinite nanocrystal helium temperature. One more thing in this luminescence, it is shortening of radiative decay time with decreased temperature inconsistent with dark exciton model. Indeed, if you have ground dark exciton state, the radiative decay time of optically passive exciton is very long, 1,000 nanosecond. Then when you rise temperature, you start to populate bright exciton level, which have short, okay, 20 nanosecond radiative decay time, but total shortening of decay time. But it is not what experiment on perovskite nanocrystal show. The decay time become dramatically shorter with decrease of temperature. This raises the question, is the low exciton state in perovskite structures bright? In this case, it would be first known example of such material. Here I show you energy band structure of cesium lead bromide perovskite material, which is typical for all perovskite. The band age of this material is at R point of Brillouin zone. That bottom of conduction band is characterized by spin 1/2, and top of the valence band also characterized by spin 1/2. And from this two spin, you create exciton with angular momentum 1 and 0. And electron hole exchange interaction split the state into the F=1 state and F=0 state. And calculation shows the triplet due to strong spin orbit coupling, it is triplet, which is bright, and singlet is dark, and singlet always lie below triplet state. Similar structure was predicted many years ago in Kapler-Hallerite nanocrystal. In calculation, we should consider only short range exchange interactions. The splitting between bright and dark exciton is very small, just 100 microelectron volt. Low temperature perovskite has orthorhombic lattice structure. And in orthorhombic lattice structure, phases split the bright triplet exciton state into three well-defined state with dipole, orthogonal dipole XYZ, which is splitting on the order 10 microelectron volt. And looking on this calculation, you can predict that this splitting is too small to see separation. So you see single emission line, which is affected by low lying dark exciton state. This is not, however, what we see in single quantum dot experiment conducted in perovskite material. The spectra show 1-3 spectral fission emission. The splitting between this line, if you have 2 or 3 spectra, is on the order 1 eV. The only one thing which is consistent, the each feature is really linear polarized. Here I show the spectra of single cesium lead bromide chloride nanocrystal measured 5 Kelvin. What is the reason? It's clear that exchange interaction alone cannot describe this property. In order to describe this property, again, it's stuck. Just a second, maybe. Not.
Саша, можно я пока спрошу вот по этой картинке? А здесь состояние, которое как бы ноль, оно совсем темное или оно с учетом вот понижения симметрии может все-таки без магнитного поля активироваться?
Нет, оно совсем темное.
То есть только в магнитном поле его можно было бы?
Только в магнитном поле его можно.
Спасибо.
Эта структура изучалась, на самом деле была большая активность по этому поводу в 60-е годы. потому что купрон-хлор был один из них основных материалов, где люди исследовали кситоны. И есть работы Бира Пикуса и Бассани, и, I don't know, 20 работ теоретических вы можете найти на этот топик, где они изучали структуру фекситона в купрон-хлоре, которая вполне идентична тому, что существует в перовской. Как мы видим это?
По-моему, очень хорошо. Правой части пока не видим, но, наверное, сейчас вы щелкните, она появится.
Вот, появилась мышка, слава богу. To explain this phenomenon, we decided to involve Rajbe effect. Indeed, in organic perovskite, there was a giant Rajbe term was measured in organic perovskite. And here I show you invariant affecting the electron and hole spectrum in cubic perovskite material, where N is inversion asymmetry direction. The perovskite as observation Rajbe also requires strong speed orbit coupling, and it exists due to lead compound in this material. Each of these term does not affect exciton spectrum in first order perturbation theory. However, in second-order perturbation theory, this electron and hole spin are mixed through intermediate exciton state if sum goes over all intermediate exciton state. As a result, this spin-spin electron-hole exchange interaction created by Rajbe term has formed effective electron-hole exchange, and straightforward calculations show that if Rajbe term for conduction and valence band have the same sign, it could move up exciton, dark exciton to the high energy and create three lower lying linear polarized bright exciton state. In order to discuss describe one MeV splitting of exciton, you need to assume that Rajbe coefficient in the order 0.4 electron volt angstrom. And for comparison, I show here the indium antimonide, indium arsenide quantum well Rajbe coefficient measures give the value 3 times smaller. In organic perovskite, this time is 20 times larger that is required. It is important to say that in order to have this Rajbe term exchange interaction, you need to be in weak or intermediate confinement regime, because you need intermediate exciton state, which would mix up Rajbe term in conduction valence band. Another important comment here is that the small size nanocrystal enhanced electron hole exchange interaction is in hell, and hence it still controls the level order. So in small nanocrystal, you will have bright ground exciton state. Let's discuss size-dependent exciton fine structure. Here I want to mention that in order to describe this fine structure, we need to take into account long-range exchange interaction. And as it was shown by Zhenya Ivchenko and Sergey Gopalov, this exchange interaction depend using tight binding approximation. This exchange interaction depends on the character of an optical transition occurring in unit cell. If this transition occurs on the same atom of unit cell, this exchange interaction cubic shape nanocrystal could be neglected. If it occurs between different atom of unit cell, like between cadmium and selenide in castellanite unit cell, it has a full magnitude of the exchange interaction. So this exchange interaction should be characterized by phenological parameter gamma, which is zero for if transition in perovskite occur on the one single lead ion, and should be one if transition occur between different ion of unit cell. So this long range exchange increases the splitting value and the fine structure of the splitting level. However, the order of level of triplet and do not control by exchange interaction, control by crystal field splitting and sign of crystal splitting, which in the case of say tetragonal perturbation moves the XY level down and Z level up. This is not consistent with experimental data reported by Brahim Luni's group, who tried to find a ground dark exciton state in this material and study behavior of single quantum dot in magnetic field. He didn't find dark state, but he very well defined the order of level. You see in magnetic field, upper level splitting, so XY level should be above, and lower level should be Z character. Importantly, Rajbetom not only flip order the optically dark exciton state above optically active exciton state, it also create a structure where XY level is above Z level, consistent with observation by Brahim Zunis. So here I show you a calculation of fine structure of exciton level perovskite, which we neglect Rajbetom. Calculator of three parameter gamma characterize exchange interaction. You see the ground state always dark and distance between level increases, decrease of nanocrystal size. And here I show the same calculation conducted if you take into account Rajbetom. In this calculation, the ground exciton state is bright in large nanocrystal, but in small nanocrystal become above dark exciton level. The difference, however, behavior of the splitting between two bright exciton is significant, because in the case of Rajbetom, the distance between bright exciton level decreases with decreased nanocrystal size, while in this case, it will be increasing with decrease of nanocrystal size. And this actually allow you to distinguish between one model and another, even if you case if you cannot see dark exciton state. So the experimental data show strong confirmation of our model, and here I show typical single nanocrystal polarized curve measured at 5 Kelvin from this 3-peak line, which clearly indicates the luminescence comes from 3 orthogonal linear polarized dipole. The radiative decay time measured in this structure also show very short decay time, which varies from 0.85 to 0.2 nanosecond. And we show you now that photonic decay time not only so short, but also describes this decay time quantity. It would be simple problem in simple spherical nanocrystal, where indeed, because probability of light emission proportional to this square matrix element taken between exciton and unperturbed state of nanocrystal. However, in cubic shape nanocrystal like perovskite, electric field of photon inside nanocrystal is inhomogeneous. Let me explain, and this makes some complication in calculation. Let me remind you what I am talking about. If you apply homogeneous electric field to the electric sphere, it creates electric sphere inside the sphere, which magnitude is reduced by the electric screening, which depends on the ratio of the electric constant inside and outside nanocrystal. If you apply the homogeneous electric field to a cubic shaped nanocrystal or dielectric, it also reduces its value due to the electric screening, but inside nanocrystal becoming homogeneous. Electric field has maximum value at the center of nanocrystal. Here I show two-dimensional distribution of Z component of electric field created by the homogeneous electric field in Z direction. You see a maximum screening of electric field occur in the facet normal to electric field and smallest screening occur in the facet tangential to the electric field. In addition, in spherical nanocrystals, the electric field inside the electric sphere is parallel to external electric field. Not case for cubic shaped nanocrystal. This field along Z direction generated X and Y component of electric field inside cube. And here show two-dimensional distribution of this X component of electric field in the ZX mid-plane. Importantly, this field changes sign if it go vertical Z direction. Now let's compare the radiative decay time in spherical perovskite and cubic shaped perovskite. In spherical perovskite, this decay time can be written in such standard form, proportional emission frequency, refractive index, Ken energy parameter, D depolarization factor, K square of overlap integral, where V is a wave function of excitons in nanocrystal. In cubic shaped nanocrystal, you can write decay rate for each of three orthogonal linear polarized dipole, very similar form, where due to inhomogeneous electric field, I parallel square replace D square K, where I parallel average Z component of electric field with the exciton wave function. For importantly, I perpendicular averaging S component, Y component of electric field with wave function ground state is vanishes due to odd character of this wave function, even character wave function of ground state. And due to this property, linear polarized dipole in cubic shape nanocrystal emit linear polarized light despite of the fact the electric field of photon inside the nanocrystal is inhomogeneous.
So, извините, а можно быстрый вопрос?
Да.
Но ведь, наверное, все равно этот нанокристалл очень маленький по сравнению с длиной волны. То есть поле там внутри, конечно, немножко неоднородно, но для дипольных переходов это не важно.
Ну, it depends, this depends on degree of inhomogeneity. Если бы это было, EX было бы большое, вы бы получили Миша, я скажу так, что, скажем, вот эти дополнительные члены можно посчитать, приводят к дополнительным правилам отбора.
Скажем, они вы можете на оптической частоте происходит такое резкое изменение на оптической частоте. Там нет никакого ослабления, Миша.
Нет, Миша, по-моему, спрашивает, почему важно или это не важно.
Да, у меня наивный вопрос. Казалось бы, что эти нанокристаллы, они маленькие по сравнению с длиной волны света, включая длину волны света внутри среды. И тогда, казалось бы, ну не важно все.
Но это модуляция локального поля, Миша, которая прямо входит в вероятность излучения в квадрате. Так что...
Миша, оптический переход разрешенный тоже определяется тем же маленьким интегралом.
Это хорошо. Отношение... Нет, я подумаю, я думаю, что я соображу. Я немножко подумаю. Мне тут и Саша подобный подсказывает. Я думаю, что я сейчас соображу. Спасибо, извините.
Нет, я просто хочу сказать, что это вообще интересный вопрос, потому что, скажем, эти нанокристаллы должны показывать запрещенные переходы из-за этой неоднородности. Вы можете наблюдать в этих кристаллах, скажем, 1S, 1P transition.
Саш, а вот если ты возьмешь пирамиду какую-нибудь косую, или таких не бывает кристаллов?
Нет, бывает сейчас, конечно.
То есть ты рассказывал про кубик и сферу, которые симметричные достаточно фигуры.
Да, а сейчас уже есть и пирамидки.
Вот-вот-вот. Ждем с нетерпением.
Ну, я про это рассказывать не могу, но есть пирамидки.
Все, я понял, не буду.
И, конечно, там полно интересных. Кроме того, там вот это... Вы можете break symmetry там окончательно и убить полностью duck exit.
Конечно.
Это все очень exciting.
Это типичное то, что называется эффект Перселла в локальном поле.
Что-то напоминает нам.
Ну, ребята, я близко к концу, имейте терпение, я уже почти кончил. Так, значит, однако там был overlap integral, as you remember. And this overlap strongly depends on nanocrystal size. The strong confinement regime when Bohr radius much larger than the size of nanocrystal. Wave function of exciton is just product of independent electron hole wave function, which is identical in parabolic band approximation. In the case of weak confinement, like Bohr radius smaller than nanocrystal size, exciton behave like hydrogen atom in the box, and wave function is product of wave function of relative motion of electron hole and center of mass motion here. So using these two wave functions, we can calculate this integral which control emission rate. In the strong confinement regime, it is independent of size. In the weak confinement regime, however, it is more convenient to calculate square of this integral right away. And this gives you this large factor, ratio of nanocrystal volume to Bohr radius cube. It's a giant oscillator transition strength predicted by Professor Ashba, 1961. And
Гургенишвили, да?
Yes, it's Ashba and Гургенишвили. First paper was on organic, exciton organic media, and I don't know who was cause, but but in semiconductor, it's Ashba and Гургенишвили work. It's time to work. So using this expression, it's a Ashba and Гургенишвили work, and I would say that in nanocrystal, more important than for exciton, bound to some defects. Using this expression for strong and weak confinement regime, we can compare radiative decay time in spherical nanocrystal and cube nanocrystal with the same volume. And you see in spherical nanocrystal decay time shorter. It is because screening of external electric field of photon inside cube nanocrystal effectively larger. So our nanocrystal not in the weak, not in strong confinement regime. And we describe optical transition energy and oscillator transition strength. We use one parametric ansatz function, which characterized by this correlation parameter beta. And with this one parametric ansatz function, we calculated optical transition energy and radiative emission rate, shown here by this blue port connected by blue line for height guidance. On the top of this calculated curve, we put experimental data measuring single quantum dot experiment. We show quite good agreement between experiment and theory. Okay, after such long talk, it is natural to ask where the Nacre fissile is going. And I must admit that I don't have satisfactory answer to this question. The nanocrystal quantum dots continue to grow and develop today. The discovery of perovskite nanocrystal shows that this field has not yet achieved full maturity. Hundreds of scientists and engineers continue to work on creating a novel nanocrystal structure, on improving nanocrystal transport property, on developing numerous nanocrystal-based devices. I am pretty sure that this year Viktor Klimov was report first electrically pumped nanocrystal-based laser, and Philippe Guillon-Sionest will report room temperature mercurial telluride-based infrared photodetector, and we will have in the near future multiple inexpensive nanocrystal devices for flexible electronic, infrared detector, sensor, laser. As well, we have multiple nanocrystal medical biological applications. That is why I think it is impossible to predict where are the fast developing nanocrystal field going and what will be the most next important application or killer application for future development. But I would like to mention two directions which I scientifically find most exciting. First, I told you from the beginning that growing of nanocrystal supercrystal by Chris Moody contain great promise because you create novel material, novel solid material, which nature don't give us. Even more impressive, but this promise never actually was realized because nanocrystal and these super lattices don't talk to each other very strongly. However, recently they create also binary nanocrystal solid, which can combine the electronic and optical property of different material together. And create, say, binary nanocrystal bipolar conductivity or magnetic structure with electric constant zero. This is one of the most interesting development today, I believe. And I think that it is goal of for theoretician to predict what novel material can be created in this ground, because one day this nanostructure will be created. A second direction is, I believe, is very important practically, is creation of nanocrystal sensor of neuron activity, which replace the calcium sensor and patch clamp technique, because nanocrystal sensor can provide measurement of neuron activity with high temporary spatial resolution, which none of these sensors provided now. With this, I stop and rephrasing Willie Stark comment to Jack. I will say, if I tell you everything, there will nothing left to think about. And with this, I would like to acknowledge people who contributed my research. First and foremost, Alexei Kimov, who brought me to this research area. Multiple experimental group and experimentalists. It is impossible to overestimate the role of this my discussion with all these people. And I look like that collaborates with practically any large group working on nanocrystal. Theoretician who work with different aspects of quantum dot, Vasily Harshin and Merv Rosen on Ag processes, Steve Irwin on doping of nanocrystal, Igor Mirkov, Misha Glasov, Zhenya Ivchenko on the spintronic aspect of quantum dots, Peter Sercel, who worked with me on perovskite now, and four of my former postdoc, Anna Rodina, who is senior scientist at Yoff Institute now, Andrei Shabaev now at NRL, Josh Craig went to some collaboration, Roman Waxenburg now at HHMI, who conducted most of this quite complicated calculation. Thank you all, and I would be happy to answer any question we might have.
Саша, thank you very much. Спасибо большое. Давайте поблагодарим докладчика. И у нас еще есть время для дискуссии, для обсуждения. Пожалуйста, вопросы, комментарии.
5 минут.
Да, ну так, Евгений Ильич, даже не 5, 7 минут у вас есть. Вы из них можете 5 занять.
Я слушаю, Женя.
Нет, у меня нет вопросов. Я доволен всем.
Саша, а у тебя в заключении сказано про транспорт, транспортные свойства. Что это такое? Применительно к квантовым точкам.
Значит, вот эта работа Крис Мури, 96, suggested that if you make identical nanocrystal, да, у вас появится зонная проводимость. Долгие годы вот эти Крис Мури и другие показывали замечательные картинки периодических кристаллов. эти периодические кристаллы, у них не было коллективных свойств, поскольку эти кристаллы практически не разговаривали друг с другом. Оверлэп интеграл, который, значит, был 10 минус 6, то есть это они красиво сидели на TEM, но кристаллы не разговаривали друг с другом. За последние 5 лет ситуация резко поменялась. Значит, во-первых, эти органические молекулы, которые разделяли нанокристаллы, сделали короче. Часть из них заменили на их неорганические, сделали неорганические полупроводниковые лиганд. Нанокристаллы Доплер и Шерри Коган 5 лет назад рапортовала подвижность в этих структурах 27 электрон-вольт на сантиметр в секунду. Это consistent, in principle, with creation already bends. То есть вы можете представить, что они стали так долго разговаривать, что они создали зоны. Ясно, что для того, чтобы зоны были, надо полностью убить дизоды, etc., но эта подвижность говорит о чем-то. Если бы было 50, было бы намного лучше. Но этого еще не произошло. Теперь вы можете создать эти кристаллы разного характера. Например, Байна на кристалле. Let me show you picture. Вот, например, такие кристаллы, состоящие из двух подрешеток. Одни будут, скажем, кацелениды, а вторые будут индиантимониды. Если эти две саблетисты начнут сильно разговаривать друг с другом, вы можете, в принципе, создать биполяр семикондуктор. Электрон будет полностью проводить по одной решетке, дырки по другой решетке. Это один из проектов, которые люди стараются принести внутрь. И, конечно, таких материалов пока в природе нет. Но что из этого можно сделать, это интересно.
Спасибо.
Еще вопросы?
Саша. Можно вопрос?
Алло.
Роберт Арнольдович, у вас куда-то звук пропал.
Сейчас он есть, нет?
Да, сейчас есть, Роберт. Привет.
Привет, Саша. Слушай, так вот, в связи с этими массивами квантовых точек, которые образуют зоны, то есть все, в общем...
Хотим, чтобы образовали.
Красиво. Вопрос вот какой. Значит, ну, тут должно, видимо, будет соревнование с квантовыми точками в гетероструктурах. Полупроводниковых, я имею в виду.
Да, конечно.
Ну, и кто кого? По ощущению?
Я думаю, что коллоиды победят. Они настолько дешевле, и настолько больше людей работают сегодня над этим, что...
Нет, ну так тут же очень жесткие требования, когда я хочу делать массивы, проводящие массивы этих квантовых точек. Требования будут очень жесткие, и, по-видимому, стоить это будет немало. Нет?
Да, я согласен, но уже сейчас... Ну, просто я сравниваю... Поскольку я работаю в обоих областях, ага. Роберт, я сравниваю число людей, которые работают над вот этими холодными суперрешетками, с людьми, которые работают, ну, вот, над петоксиальной квантовой дочкой. Ну, это два порядка разницы людей. Значит, хорошо. Я думаю, что это победит.
И еще один вопрос. Вообще-то, вот эта самая россыпь квантовых точек могла бы... служить и для того, что, ну, как катализатор, скажем так. Ну, потому что катализ на полупроводниковых поверхностях – это вещь такая, с давних времен рассматриваемая. В этом направлении что-то делается или
нет? Да, абсолютно. Что заменить платину на что-то другое – ой, большие деньги крутятся.
Так дают деньги на замену, да?
Да, 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 абсолютно. Большие деньги.
Понятно.
Я правильно не понимаю химию совершенно.
Этим ты не занимаешься, да?
А? Я этим не занимаюсь, потому что я не понимаю химию совершенно. Нас не учили хорошо, но люди этим занимаются.
Спасибо.
Коллеги, еще вопросы? Ну, если нет, давайте поблагодарим докладчика еще раз. Саша, очень здорово, что вы смогли принять участие в нашем семинаре. Всего хорошего.
Я надеюсь, спасибо. Что Саша еще будет участвовать, ну, хотя бы как слушатель. Ну, конечно, рановато, но ну, что делать?
Я рассчитываю, что вы будете посылать мне...
Я буду, все. Ну, к сожалению, видишь, но фистеховский адрес у тебя не воспринимается. Мне приходится с другого адреса посылать. Но я буду
да, это большая буду проблема еще. Для меня тоже. Пожалуйста, кто хочет мне написать, пользуйтесь Gmail'ами.
Хорошо. Ну, ждем тебя еще.
Спасибо, да, спасибо большое, ребята. Да. Было очень приятно вас повидать и поговорить.
Спасибо большое. До следующего.
Спасибо. Спасибо.
Всего доброго.
Спасибо. Берегите себя. До свидания.
Спасибо.